have a fourth or fifth grader? If so, I want to invite you to register them for our summer camp, Character Quest. Camp is June 5th through the 9th here at World Outreach Church. You can register them at wochurch.org. We have tons of things going on and just so many activities for your students. They'll be sure to have a blast. Registration closes May 22nd, so register today.
Junior High Camp is back July 8th through the 12th. If you're in 6th or 7th grade, you're invited to join us at the Ocoee River for this incredible week of getting to know the Lord better and build relationships with one another. Register by June 23rd at wochurch.org. We'll see you there.
Good evening, church. Welcome to our Saturday night service. My name's Caleb, and I'm here with Mac Brock. Mac, how are you doing tonight?
I'm doing good.
Awesome. Glad to have you back. Thank you so much for being here. Hey, I want to talk to everybody on the online community really quick. We're going to play a game with Mac. I want you to, in the comments, whether you're on Facebook, YouTube, church online, I want you to tell me what your favorite Mac Brock song is. And now, Mac, I want you to try to predict what you think the audience is going to say is their favorite song that you've written.
I mean, I think my go-to would probably be Do It Again.
Do It Again?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm assuming that.
All right.
We'll see.
Good deal. Well, guys, literally, I want to know your favorite. No pandering here. We're playing a game. We're going to come back tomorrow morning. We're going to come back tomorrow morning. I'm going to go read the comments. So I'm going to jump online here in just a little bit. And we're going to tally up all your favorite songs. And then we'll come back Sunday morning and we'll see if Mac was right or not in predicting your favorite songs. But Mac, we got a lot of stuff happening here at the church. So we want to run through, but I want to get your perspective on them. So guys, we have baptism happening on Saturday nights, tonight and next weekend. Go to wochurch.org to register to be a part of that. But can you share a little bit about your personal baptism experience?
Yeah, so my dad's a Southern Baptist pastor. I grew up in the church, and I remember making the decision when I was 7 years old to finally like go down
seven
to the front of the church and make that proclamation, and it was a big deal for me.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Step of obedience and
faith. Yeah, it was awesome.
7 years old.
Yeah, yeah.
I love it. This upcoming Wednesday, we have the Katina's Hymns Concert. That's going to be 6:30 right here in Three Crosses Sanctuary. This is a free, non-ticketed event. We want you to be a part. But Mac, I'm curious. There are so many great traditional church hymns. Yeah. Is there one that stands out to you in particular?
You know, I don't know if this counts as a hymn, but that song, As the Deer,
yeah,
we grew up singing that all the time, and that is just like that's one of my favorites of all time.
Okay,
yeah.
I would not have gone right to that,
yeah,
but I love that.
I love that.
Next weekend, we have a guest speaker, Dr. Raleigh Washington's going to be with us Saturday and Sunday. You're not going to want to miss it, but in your experience, has there been a guest speaker show up that has left a lasting impression with you?
There is an evangelist named Clayton King
Clayton
from
King.
South Carolina. He's one of the pastors at New Spring Church in Anderson, and I grew up listening to him preach and have become friends with him as an adult, and he is just the best.
Okay, yeah. I'm going to have to go look him up.
Love
I'm
Clayton
not
King.
Familiar.
Shout out Clayton.
And then, guys, later this summer in June and July, we have our junior high and our Character Quest camp. You can go sign up for that, find all the information online. But, Mac, really quick, your favorite summer camp memory as a child?
We used to go to Big Stuff Camp, which is in Daytona Beach. It was like Louis Giglio.
Okay.
Before Passion Church and all that stuff. And that one had a lasting impact on me. You wouldn't think a bunch of like middle schoolers and high schoolers at a beach would be a good idea, but it was very special.
It worked. It worked. Guys, go online, find all the information you need, but stick around. Mac's about to lead us in worship. God bless.
Church, we have baptisms happening Saturdays after service. If you haven't taken the step of faith, I want to invite you to come be baptized in our outdoor sanctuary. You can register at wochurch.org. Excited to host the Katina's Hymns Concert Wednesday, May 24th. This is a free, non-ticketed event. Join us for an evening of worship.
Hey folks, make an intentional choice to be in community with God's people. I want to invite you to join a small group and be a part of a community of believers who can strengthen your faith and help you navigate life from a Christ-centered perspective. When we encourage one another, we find courage for ourselves. You can get connected by going to our website at wochurch.org or stop by our small groups counter in the main lobby. We'd love to see you there.
Dr. Raleigh Washington will be our guest speaker on May 27th and 28th. Go to wochurch.org for all the details, and we'll see you here.
Or fifth grader? If so, I want to invite you to register them for our summer camp, Character Quest. Camp is June 5th through the 9th here at World Outreach Church. You can register them at wochurch.org. We have tons of things going on and just so many activities for your students. They'll be sure to have a blast. Registration closes May 22nd, so register today.
Junior High Camp is back July 8th through the 12th. If you're in 6th or 7th grade, you're invited to join us at the Ocoee River for this incredible week of getting to know the Lord better and build relationships with one another. Register by June 23rd at wochurch.org. We'll see you there.
Faithful in every season. let us go. Whatever we face, He's right by our side. Come on, we believe this together. This is true. God is always working, always moving. So rain came, wind blew, but my house was built on You. Yes, it was. I'm safe with You. I'm gonna make it through. Whatever it is, give it up right now. Rain came, wind blew, my house was built on great are you, Lord. Come on, it's your breath. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour. So good. And great are you,
all my life you have been faithful.
all my life you have been so, so good, yeah. Every breath that I breathe, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Yeah. This is true. We serve a living God who's right here with us.
Oh, what a Savior. Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Yes, He is. So bow down before. Forgiveness, yes there is, and it was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. special time of worship. That was incredible. Hey, y'all can have a seat and take a look at the screens.
Amen.
Good evening, everyone. How are you? We're so glad that you all are here. I want to welcome each of you and our online audience to our service tonight. What do you think about that video? Isn't that amazing? It makes you want to go to camp, doesn't it? Character Quest is a camp that we have here at the church every summer. And Character Quest marks this season of camps here at the church. In a couple of weeks, we're going to have several hundred students, outgoing fourth and fifth graders, and counselors and volunteers that are going to be occupying our campus here at World Outreach. We're really looking forward to that. It's an amazing time that that we have with them. The church will be filled with the aromas, not of children, but of the muffins that we'll be cooking in one of the kitchens here. We have Character Quest is not an entertainment camp, even though we have lots of fun with Character Quest. But it is, we invite our fourth and fifth graders to not only love and honor the Lord, but to put the Lord at the center of their lives. And we encourage them to do that in everything that we do here on campus, in every activity. I had the great pleasure of serving in Character Quest for about 15 years and as a camp counselor, and then now as part of the pastoral staff here at the church. I still feel like I'm very much a part of it. And for years and years, I heard story after story of how God had shown up in the lives of the folks that attend this camp and what God is doing in this place. I'd like to ask all of you, with Character Quest fast approaching, if you would join us in prayer for Character Quest. And we want to put Christ Jesus right in the very center of it. We want all that Christ has for us. So if you would, for offertory prayer tonight, I would like to pray for Character Quest. So if you wouldn't mind standing. And I invite our online audience to also stand. So let's pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you for the opportunity of Character Quest, and I thank you for all the planning and the staff and the volunteers that have diligently and done so well with the planning of this event. We thank you for their hearts to serve people. I thank you for the children, Lord Jesus, that you are sending to this camp, and for the parents and the grandparents that have made sacrifices so that their children and grandchildren can be a part of this camp. And Lord, we thank you for all the volunteers, the counselors, the food folks, all the tech, the production, everything that it takes to make Character Quest work. Lord, we thank you for their hearts to serve. I pray, Lord, that we have wonderful weather that week,
that the weather would not in any way impede on what you have for us here. And Lord, as your sweet Holy Spirit sweeps this place, I pray that it will meet everyone here, that their hearts would be opened and their minds would be open to all that you have for each and every one of them. Lord, we thank you and praise you and honor you in all that you do. In the precious name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Bless you all. Thank you, sir.
Well, good evening to all of you, and may the Lord just richly bless us for being here tonight. I appreciate all of you. I appreciate this church and the opportunity of being here. I especially appreciate Pastor Allen inviting me. And we need to gather together like this to remind ourselves of how God guides every one of us through whatever it is that we may go through. When I was in graduate school, I found a song that somehow I'd never heard before. It was an old gospel song, and I learned it. And at that time, I was trying to figure out what to do about a career and a ministry and about getting married and everything else. And this old song was a prayer, and I learned it almost instantly. And it said, "Jesus, Savior, pilot me over life's tempestuous sea. Unknown waves before me roll, hiding rock and dangerous shoal. Chart and compass come from thee. Jesus, Savior, pilot me." And to me now, that is still a prayer of my life, because we do go through storms, and sometimes the water is choppy. Some of you may be going through choppy waters or stormy weather right now. We never get too far away from some kinds of difficulties that we didn't expect. But we have all of these stories in the Bible about how Jesus is able to guide us through tempestuous times. And one of the greatest of all stories is the shipwreck, the voyage and the shipwreck of St. Paul the Apostle at the end of the book of Acts. So if you have your Bibles, or maybe you have the handout for tonight, turn with me to the book of Acts and chapter number 27 and 28. This is a very vivid passage. There's something I really don't understand. I have been in church all of my life. Now, granted, many of those years I've been preaching, but I've been in churches listening to sermons for many, many years, and I almost have never heard a sermon on this passage. And even in Sunday school, you know, we have the story of David and Goliath and the story of the little boy breaking the loaves, but somehow I don't remember ever having a class in Sunday school on the shipwreck of St. Paul the Apostle. And yet it's the longest single narrative story in the book of Acts. It's a tremendously vivid story. Luke, who wrote the Gospel of Acts, was present here on this doomed ship. And the passage itself is the most vivid account, live account, eyewitness account of an ancient shipwreck in all of antiquity. So it's a very wonderful story, but the best thing of all is out of this story, we can extrapolate some lessons about what we should do when we encounter some stormy weather. And so I have drawn out 10 different principles from this story in Acts 27 and 28. I call them the Mediterranean Sea Rules, 10 principles about navigating life's tempestuous sea. And I want to deal with 5 of them tonight. In the morning, I'll deal with the other 5. But the first 5, I'm just going to give you. We'll look at the text. I'll say some words about it. It's going to be very simple. But here is the first one. When your plans collapse, make sure that you don't. When your plans collapse, make sure that you don't. So let's begin here in Acts 27, verses 1 and 2. When it was decided that we would sail for Italy, Paul and some of the other prisoners were handed over to a centurion named Julius, who belonged to the imperial regiment. We boarded the ship from Adramyttium, about to sail for ports along the coast of the province of Asia, and we put out to sea. Aristarchus, a Macedonian from Thessalonica, was with us. Now, the background here is very important. I've dealt with this a little bit in previous sermons here, but I want to just review it for you in case you don't know exactly what is happening, because the story just, it really begins in Acts chapter 20, when the Apostle Paul is finishing his third missionary tour. He comes down to the city of Corinth. He has finished everything that he wanted to do. And so he now begins to plan a fourth missionary tour. And he decides that he wants to go to Spain. And he meets in Acts chapter 20 and verse number 3. We know this from several different cross references, in the home of Gaius, a wealthy person in Corinth, and he meets with his advisors. He's a strategist, and he plans this fourth missionary tour. And then he decides that he is going to go to Jerusalem and take the offering that he has collected from the churches of Asia and Europe and take it down to the church in Jerusalem that was impoverished and deliver that offering. And then he was going to go on to Rome, and from Rome he was going to go to Spain. And many scholars believe that Paul really thought that he could fulfill the Great Commission in his generation by taking the gospel to the very western edges of the Mediterranean world and of the Roman Empire. And so he made all of those plans to leave Corinth, go to Jerusalem, leave the offering there, then go to Rome, and then on to Spain. And he wrote to the Romans, and he told them, this is what I'm going to do. So let me go over to Romans chapter 15, because I want you to see this. He says in Romans 15 and verse number 23, he said, but now there is no more place for me to work in these regions. And since I've been longing for many years to visit you, I plan to do so when I go to Spain. I hope to see you while passing through and to have you assist me on my journey there after I have enjoyed your company for a while. Now, however, I'm on my way to Jerusalem in the service of the Lord's people there, for Macedonia and Achaia were pleased to make a contribution to the poor among the Lord's people in Jerusalem. And they were pleased to do it, and indeed they owe it to them. And he goes on in verse 28, so after I have completed this task and have made sure that they have received this contribution, I will go to Spain and visit you on the way. I know that when I come to see you, I will come in the full measure of the blessings of Christ. And so he sent that letter on to Rome while he went to Jerusalem intending to be there just a few days, deliver the offering, and then go on to Spain. Nothing happened the way he expected. Nothing did. Every plan he made fell apart. He got to Jerusalem and was immediately the center of controversy there. And he provoked a riot. He didn't mean to, but his very presence in the city, it was a very volatile time in that city, and the Romans captured him to protect him from being pummeled to death by the mob. And then he was imprisoned in Jerusalem by the Romans and narrowly flogged and then narrowly assassinated. So they moved him to the Roman city of Caesarea on the Israeli coast, and there he was imprisoned for 2 years. And then they put him on this ill-fated ship. And we have what's going to unfold in chapters 27 and 28. And then he finally got to Rome, but he was in prison there for at least another 2 years. In other words, Paul prayerfully made carefully thought through plans, and he committed them to God. And he told other people what they were, and they all fell apart. But he didn't. He never did. He understood the sovereign God is over all of the affairs of men. He had committed his plans to the Lord, and when they didn't work out, well, he accepted that. Now, I believe the Lord wants us to set goals, and to make plans. Both individually and as congregations, we need to do that. But when our plans are committed to the Lord, then He navigates the route. And He doesn't always take us exactly where we expect. It may be different than we planned. But here's what is so important. This is the secret of the Christian experience of guidance. Detours often are God's thoroughfares. Detours are often God's thoroughfares, and disappointments are His sovereign appointments. Now, we don't always see that immediately, but I want to tell you, when I look back over my life, I've had some real moments of disappointment. And when that disappointment comes, it just sort of punches you in the stomach. And some of you maybe in this past week have suffered some disappointment. But if you will give it some time, it's all going to open a door to greater blessings than you would have had than if the thing you're disappointed about had actually happened. That's the amazing thing about the providence of God. And I can look back now, if I had time, I could give you example after example of times when I was so disappointed about something. But now looking back, I say, hallelujah, Lord, that You closed that door and I had that disappointment because it was Your sovereign appointment and You were simply preparing me for something greater. And this is exactly what was true for Paul. His plans didn't work out, but it's because God had deeper, better, richer, more vivid, more exciting, more exhilarating plans than Paul could have conceived on his own in that villa of Gaius with his friends at the end of his third missionary tour. You know, I'll give you one very brief example. I probably wouldn't be standing here tonight speaking to you if the city of Lahore had not sunk in New York Harbor into the Hudson River in 1918. That was a great ship, and this was the end of World War I, and I had a man whose family I know. His name was Robert C. McQuilkin, and he was going to go on the City of Lahore, that great steamship, to Africa with his family to be missionaries there. And this was at a time at the end of the war when there were very few ships now back on, passenger ships back on the oceans. But he found the City of Lahore, he booked passage, his family put all of their things.